At the sound test earlier, I trialled a new poem upon you. I've been rewriting it ever since, during the interval. And so I'm going to trial that again, okay? It's called Dr. Seuss Enters Through the Gates of Heaven. You have come to a place where the streets are not marked. Some windows are lighted, but mostly they're darked. And you hear a song rising over the snow. It starts in low, and it starts to grow. Now your snow is all white. Now your work is all done. Now your house is all right. I will not let you fall. I will hold you up high as I stand on a ball with a book in one hand and a cup in my hat. Now, now, have no fear, says the cat. Has it got better? I dropped a line. Let's get straight to the action of this poem. I was very honoured to be commissioned by Poets and Players to write this poem for the Manchester Science Year. It took me a while to fast on to a subject, folks, but I finally got down to a man I much admire called Andre Guy, who teaches at the University of Manchester. And the thing I liked about him was that he had this understanding of science I used to possess, that it was like Lego. I read Lego in your laboratory, but only so much Lego. And so that restriction on your Lego restricted nothing but your imagination. And that reminded me of poetic form and how restriction is liberation. He also did fantastic research upon levitating a frog in a magnetic field. So the frog was up and about in magnetism. And he also did lots of work upon geckos and their sticky feet and how we might use gecko sticky feet technology to help us out. But the best thing he did was he wrote a scientific paper with his favourite hamster. This implies more than one hamster, right? So imagine what the unfavourite hamster felt about this. But he wrote this paper with a hamster Eichster, I think he called him, and published it, and then claimed that hamster went on to apply to do a PhD at the University of Nijmegen. All this I found utterly charming about Andre Guy and his discovery of graphene. It involved a lot of play, graphene, the discovery of graphene at the University of Manchester. He had this scotch tape, and he had some graphite, and he simply was playing with the graphite. He was putting scotch tape on it and pulling away layers, and then placing those scotch tapes with the layers against other scotch tape and keeping pulling away until finally he found a single layer of this new super strong structure called graphene. He also said this, he said that discovering graphene was a bit like having the Large Hadron Collider. He said, the Large Hadron Collider, but on your desktop, which I'd rather like the size of the dimensions of those landing in front of you. This is the poem that fell out after much action. The discovery of graphene, University of Manchester, 2004. A single sheet of graphene, being one atom thick, sufficient in size to cover a football pitch, would weigh under one single gram. Like graphene, a poem's gird is strong yet essentially unseen, a singing mesh more sinew than structural steel. Andre Guy once levitated a frog and wrote a paper with his hamster. Gaim and friend Novoselov were at play in his laboratory that day with graphite and scotch tape, gaming with science and art on their worktop while Manchester stood stone still. Patience and slow exfoliation of atom-thick layers. What art was there when they stripped the mineral strata and the poetry opened before them as atoms, and atoms, and atoms, unfurled in a singing mesh. I was told to stop and to give a pause for that one so you could film it for the science people. So that's your pause, ladies and gentlemen. On we go. I'm originally trained as an ecologist, sure, and this poem is about a friendship I had with another freshwater ecologist called Nicholas Farrar Hughes. We talked about science all the time, and we journeyed upon the felt tops and did lots of sampling. We never talked about the fact that his father was Ted Hughes and his mother was Sylvia Plath. Not once. Dragonflies. This water's steep and deep. There are signs in artery red that let us pump with advice, but it's June, and we have trod ourselves senseless, sampling some imaginary species of coleoptera. So, there are our cautions slung down like life vests by the river, and with stone drop certainty, we launch out from a hanging ledge to collide with a chill so stinging it was like flinging your body into a bed of nettles. Then headbutting the surface to see at eyelash level the whip hands of common backswimmers surge and sprint, each footing a tiny dazzle to prism. Then these sparking ornaments hovering, then islanding on our shoulders, each arching its thorax into a question. What is the blue that midnights all blue? How can crimson redden before you? The old map mutters that here be dragons, and it lies. Here be darters, skimmers, drawn flame. Here be dragonflies. The invisible gift. John Clare weaves English words into a nest, and in the cup he stipples rhyme like mud to clutch the shape of something he can hold, but not yet hear. And in the hollow of his hearing, he feathers a space with a down of verbs and nouns heads up. There, Clare lays it down and nestles over its forming sound, taps and lilts the steady knocking of the nib in his hand until it hatches softly beneath him. And when he peers below his palm, he spies his eyes, hears his peeps, but does not yet know what to think. He strokes its tottering yolk-wet crown, feels a nip against his thumb, buds of muscle springy at the wing, and all the hungers of the world to come for this small singing. Now that's the first poem of a book called The Gypsy and the Poet, which basically is an account of a friendship between the gypsy Wisdom Smith and the poet John Clare, or the so-called peasant poet John Clare. And this friendship is something I discovered in Clare's notebooks, and have since corroborated it also from all sorts of sources. This book is very odd in that it kind of wrote itself. I didn't have to struggle a lot with these things. They're all sonnets, and they're kind of written by Gypsy Smith and John Clare, not by me at all. In fact, I think Gypsy Smith and John Clare should probably take my fee for Poets and Players, because they're here. I won't read 2 minutes, but we'll get the angle of the drama here. Mostly they're chatting towards each other. This opens with a quote from the Stanford Advertiser of the time, and it's actually written by a preacher about gypsies. So the quote is, "This atrocious tribe of wandering vagabonds ought to be made outlaws and exterminated from the earth. A clergyman writes." John Clare strides to Emmonsale's Heath with the poisonous passage. Wisdom lights his pipe with it. "Spark one up for yourself, brother, but don't scorch a sonnet by mistake." Clare was scribbling lines on the brim of his hat, his paper riffling in the breeze. "My dad said all along, when the Gentile way of living and the gypsy way of living come together, well, that is anything but a good way of living, except for your rhyming and your botanizing and your good pie, poet." Two jabbing magpies strut about the camp on a pinprick search. "Take those twin piebald creatures begging for our bread. They would pick out our eyes and hearts while we lying dead. All that holds them up is life. The grave is an empty church." Mad. Wisdom Smith smiles into a steaming bowl. "March hares grow spooked in their bouts, so trussed by their boxing you can pluck them into a sack by the ones of their ears." John Clare hungers. He hugs his bowl and starts writing on the surface of the stew with a spoon. "Let the hair cool on the night wind," urges the gypsy. "Sip him, but do not speak." The moon uncovers her face, the men slumber with minds awake, for the stew has another mind, and unpours the bowls into the pot, shivering to stillness in a dying blaze, until the broth is spring water and hanks, ribs and lanky legs that dress themselves in bloody fur. Then a living hare leaps from the pot, dancing around gypsy and poet, who for this moment, before morning, are asleep in the great spell, and who dream of striding backwards to Emmonsale's heath, to where mad hares spar and clash over the surface of the earth. Obviously, Gypsy, Wisdom Smith and John Clare were very keen on writing in sonnet form. They suddenly taught me a thing or two. Andrew Biswell, this one's for you. Wisdom Smith and John Clare had a lot of piss-ups together. This is the morning after. It's called Bender, okay? Let us relate, opens with somebody speaking, John Clare. Let us relate our stoucious tales of last night. John Clare howls and Wisdom hoots at the memory of them, fleeing, filching a lanthorn and a flagon of ale, then dossing and drinking until dawn in a ramshackle shack which by the morning had completely caved in around them. We were like barn owls on a beam, cries the poet, out staring, upstanding. You, brother, touch the gypsy, is still drunk, or any road drunk in some idea. It is the poetry of night, Wisdom. That is, if any barny gypsies use for your reveries and romancing, it is where we slept, brother. But it is a singing summer. We will wind willows into benders. Poetry is in season, laughs John. Rooms woven from wound wood are like rooms of woven words. Wisdom looks at Claire. Hard. Poetry is not everything. You know that, John, smiles the gypsy. You are wrong, dances Claire. Everything is poetry. There aren't enough fights in contemporary poetry, but here's one. They have a disagreement. It's called The Hedgehog. John Clare is in a brown huff. Wisdom Smith is boxing the air, prancing about him like a stoat. Poets are prickly creatures, jabs Wisdom, for all your talk of not having a second skin. So, gypsies are way-eyed, one-faced simpletons, sulks Clare. Never an enigmatic word, hearts fairly leaping off their sleeves. I should skin you alive for that, scowls the gypsy. Slit your throat, singe, gut, and truss you like a pullet. Wrap your poet's spiky pelt in thumb thick clay and plumb you into a fire pit. Pluck clay from your roasted trunk and serve up the dish called poetry, all heart and squashy muscles. Claire bunches himself into a ball. I would bind myself so tight by that I would never unroll. If a hedgehog were not a curl, we'd pop him into a pot of hot water. The gypsy springs with the poet. The poet rabbit punches him in the gut. Wisdom is winded and laughing. Claire grabs the kettle and runs for it. A steeple climber. The Bluebell Inn on Woodgate in the small hours after time. I was thinking, slurs John Clare, now I can turn a poem, I might turn to an even thornier art. Like hedge laying, you mean, winks Wisdom. There is more coin in snedding than blotting. My friend, there are men of merit and name who pleach whole hedges of words. They call it criticism. What I want, Clare pounds the deal table, is more scale. Mishearing, the landlord stumps over with a brimming joke. I just mean, stammers John, to be taken to heart by those men. I've been a steeple climber all my life, such as my poor pen. John glares into his ale. Wisdom flickers a finger towards the ceiling. He blows the slow column of smoke up. Everybody in the pub stares and sees what a gypsy has made. There is the steeple. This, Wisdom circles his arm. This is the church and the people. The act. Wisdom swings to his feet as if pulled by an invisible hand. I shall show how this world wags without making one sound. And the gypsy transforms himself first into a lawyer. He bends a burning eye on invisible jurors. He simpers. He stands on his head as the judge and thunders silent sentence. Then Wisdom levitates to tiptoe in pity and pride as a reverend bent over his Bible. while an invisible scaffold gasps and bounces from ropes of recoil. The gypsy hangs kicking until hacked down by invisible blades. The world grinds to a stop on invisible springs, bearings, and axis. Do you ever tell lies, wisdom? All a long day through, brother, laughs the gypsy. He lights his long pipe beneath his hat's brim. But the brassiest of lies, the gypsy plucks, are like this heather, a charm against visible harm, and he crushes it, invisible harm. And the friends look at each other across the invisible stage of grass. Therein ends the Claire Wisdom Smith poems, and here's the one about storytelling. It's written from the point of view of a protagonist who happens to be half gypsy, half Gentile, and is a storyteller to a tribe. At that point, there's no biographical connection between this poem and myself at all, okay? It's a protagonist. And the poem is called Spinning. Are you all okay? I'm aware I've had to go quite fast because of the time restriction of 4 p.m. We all get chucked out of here. Spinning. I love those stories. When the world they wake brightens on the horizon of your own eye, as though another sun had neared us in the night, or some new star flowered from the dark matter. They shift in a single movement of mind or image. A suicide leaps into space, but lands on a high ledge, where he is found by fishermen with ropes and jokes. The man says he thought the night was his own death, and it was, nearly. His hair has sprung into white fright, as if his head had been dipped into the dyes of the dawn. What's expected of me, more so because unexpected, is that I will go on telling and making and spinning, more so because I was guilty of the crime called happiness. Stories for children, we know, all of us, are children. And now that I possess only my own poised possession, that I shall deliver these tales from some darker attention. There they squat around the fires with their teeth glittering. They are moving on from their roll-ups to their shared pipes, from red wine to glugs of gold whiskey. They are settling in as if they were waiting for some long haul between settlements. They say language shows you. So, my stories should show you what worlds I've wound through, whose voices I breathed in, that smoke spooling from their mouths, the fire's smoke swirling above them would make an understood utterance, a ghost of what we see, what we pass through, and what might be watching us, watching ourselves, watching. If that's too curdled for you, try truth. A 5-year-old boy dies. His parents bide by his body for 3 days. Then they fill a rucksack with his best-loved toys. Another rucksack embraces the child's body. They drive to a cliff, hitch on the rucksacks, and throw themselves spinning off the earth. What does their tale say about how much they loved each other and how much they're still loved? And was loved. Their story makes something cease in you. They drove as if going on holiday in a camper van. They say language shows you, and this story shows to me that truth and even love grow impossibly possible. This is not what you've come for, it is not what you wanted. Where is the magic-eyed metaphor that reverses them into life? Why am I not spilling word lotions into your ears that allow these 3 loving people to meet in another place, laughing and singing and unbroken? Why doesn't the story wake the boy? My own story interests nobody. Not now I'm on my own. Making story costs them nothing but my drink and caravan. It's the hour before I begin, when the clouds close down and I'm lacking of language and in a desert of image and nothing knows nothing. I am not even nowhere. Now the word trail slows in my mind. My blood sheds all sugar and I can recognize no thing, not even the walls of my van or who I am or what I will later maybe become. I used to reach out at these times, touch my wife and say, my wife. Then I would come back. I would come back into life. This is the final poem. And it's an account of the amblings of two bears through Victorian England as part of a clan of gypsies. When my wife and I were expecting our first child, she said to me that we should give the child a Romany name. So I looked some Romany names up and I came up with some corkers, one of which was Paprika and another which was Pawpaw. In fact, I've just been writing a long poem about the death of Winston Smith in my next book, in which I cover about 250 really wicked, real names from Victorian times. They're astonishing. Can you imagine going around the world being literally called Cleopatra? Wouldn't that be great? Anyway, these are amazing names. However, we decided not to, well, she decided not to call our child Paprika or Pawpaw. We called him Gabriel instead. Now, this poem is dedicated to Gabriel, who's now 10 years old. So these two bears are called Pawpaw and Paprika, and they're travelling through Victorian England. And the poem makes use of English Romany words for towns and cities. And these words always say something particular or secret about what gypsies really think of that county, of that city. So, for example, Lincolnshire. Lincolnshire is called Papineski Ten, which means literally flat duck county. No. This is flat duck county. And Oxford, there's Lillingrest Gav, which is, means two things actually. One of which is a town made of books. Or it could also mean a town made of readers. And Suffolk is known to Romanies as Dinello Ten, which means the fool's county. So something obviously went wrong in Dinello Ten at some point for gypsies. Before I finish, can I thank excellent co-readers Tanya and Gemma, Michael as well, poets and players for inviting me, all of you, but also Linda Chase. Linda Chase founded Poets and Players with Chris, right? And I taught Linda in 2003 at Arvon Foundation at Totley Barton. And one of the things that she was great at, she was a great participant in class, she produced amazing poems that went into her Carcanet collection. But she also did Tai Chi, remember? Yeah. And so I would do a fairly vigorous 3-hour workshop and get everybody kind of razzed up. And then she would take the whole group outside and they would do Tai Chi and calm down after that workshop. It would put them into a great place for writing. I remember sitting down with her at Totley and talking about, she was talking to me about the necessity for having something like this where musicians and poets come together and celebrate their art in public. I'm so glad you've got your Arts Council funding back, folks. Well done. And I'm so glad these things are continuing in this great space, and with you, great people. And you, gentlemen, sir, who've just come in. Excellent. Have a seat. So, these two bears. It's called bears. Pawpaw and Paprika. Two great bears of the Egyptians of Lancashire. The witches county, Chorwenniski Ten. Who, when our camp plucked its tents, and pulled out its maps, walked steadily with the wagons, ambling, always ambling, all across the open pages of wet England, footing as far as Papineski Ten, the flat duck county, crossing to Curo Mengreski Gav, the boxer's town, padded on to poor Ponuco Ten, Apple Water County. As good for bears as for the gypsy masters. Although who is master is moot after much apple water. Then to bide by Bokra Mengreski Ten, the shepherd's county, for though collies are trained not to bark at bears, but slyly, gently, slink, big-eyed as children behind their shepherd's greeting. Ambling bears, always ambling, mooching to my Debalescu Tem, my God's town, and God for all bears too, God of paws and padding, of polo, cardiac and koala, sniffing superiorly through Dinello Turn, the fool's county, circling with our circus to Sham and Kresky Gyre, Cham his town, nosing north through Lille and Kresky Gav, a town made of Vedas. Then pause over eyes for Carol O'Gav, the black town. Joy at Jinim and Kresky Gav, the sharper's town. To Lancashire, as it was then, wider county of white witches, to the clean camps, to the great brown bears of the Egyptians, to pawpaw and paprika. Backwards in time, they go, pad, pad. Goodbye. Thank you.